57th and 158th Street, the home of Arthur Taylor. Right over there was the home of Jack McClane and Duke Ellington. Abby Lincoln was up here. Sonny Rollins, Bud Powell, Thelonious Monk. In 86, I went to school at William Patterson College. Every weekend I used to go stay with my brother John on 106th and Broadway. And we'd play in the street, trombone and drums, just to make enough money to get some Chinese luncheon specials, some El Presidentes to have at night. One night, he brought out the Musician Union book, phone book with all the names in it. Sonny Rollins, Horace Silver, Alvin Jones, Walter Bishop, Walter Davis, all these guys. And I would call every single one of them. Some would hang up on me, some wouldn't answer, and some I became friends with. When I got to Arthur Taylor, I couldn't believe him. I called him up, had a nice chat, and the next day I had a drum lesson, 3 o'clock. I took the subway up here, I got a little lost, but I got to his apartment. I was walking down the hallway, and he leaned down and said, "Farnsworth?" I said, "Yes." "Yes, sir." And he's like, "3 o'clock. If you're not on time, you can't play in time." I learned that from Dexter Gordon. And so I was already got the chills even before I met him. That was my first lesson. Arthur Taylor wrote a tremendous book called Notes and Tones, where he interviewed all the great musicians that he grew up with. It's a tremendous view into what they thought about. Anyways, he gave me a book. Cost me $25. I remember I lent it to the great Jesse Davis at William Patterson College. I never got the book back. So in my next lesson, I said, "Oh, Mr. Taylor, I'm sorry. I need to buy another book." And he says, "Farnsworth, that'll be $25. I said, "Yeah, but at Barnes & Noble, it's only $20. He says, "Yes, but young man, you're getting straight from the author." And he said it with that mustache, and he had a nice ascot. And he looked so tall, even though we were the same height, but he looked taller. He used to wear these boots, playing boots, like ankle dress shoes. And they were just so hip, but the way he presented himself. So I bought the book for $25 to Joe Arthur Taylor. And his name was Arthur, but he liked to say author, which I thought was very funny.
In 1994, Art Taylor gave me this book at the Village Vanguard. He inscribed it, "To Anne, hope you enjoy this book. Happy Mother's Day. 1994, Art Taylor." I'll read a bit of the foreword. The purpose of this book is to pay homage to several of the musicians and to the music that has contributed vital knowledge, joy, and pleasure in my life. When I first started as a professional drummer more than 30 years ago, my decision was based on the pure joy and pleasure of playing music. It was a passion then, and it still is now. When later I had the opportunity to share musical experiences with people like Bud Powell, Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, it was a dream come true. I learned as I traveled to many cities around the world just how effective music serves as a universal language. When you like what you do, to have other people enjoy it, plus not having to do a 9-to-5 job, is like icing on the cake. Looking back at my association with musicians like Jackie McLean, Kenny Dorham, Paul Chambers, Sonny Rollins, Oscar Pettiford, Red Garland, and John Coltrane, I have come to the conclusion that my life has been one of luxury. I will always be grateful for the opportunities they provided. Thank you, Art Taylor. Thank you.
You know, the first time I had a rehearsal with AT, it was at his house. You know, it was maybe about 11 a.m., if I remember correctly. And when I went over there, you know, I got in and AT said, take out your horn, you know. And he said, what do you want to play? And naturally, I wanted to impress AT. So, you know, what I said was, let's play Tuna, you know. But I was really thinking what I'm going to do is, since he was the drummer on Countdown, you know, I figured I would, and Countdown is a contrafact of Tune Up, I would play the melody of Tune Up, but kind of surprise him and impress him with the changes of Countdown. So as it goes, we play the melody, and I get about maybe 8 bars into my solo, you know, and all of a sudden, man, AT, man, he had this way of coming down and spanking the snare drum, you know, the skin, and whack, you know. When he did that, I mean, I jumped. Everything stopped, you know. And he stopped. And I was just kind of like, okay, what's going on? And I remember he wasn't really looking at me. He was kind of looking off to the side. And he was going, And then he says, okay, let's try it again. And so we go through the melody again. And this time I only got about maybe 4 measures into my solo before he did it again. Man, he came down and whap, man, he spanked the snare drum. And when he did that, I knew it was to stop, you know, and I stopped. And I remember he put his sticks down on his floor, on his bass drum, and he stood up, you know. And I think if I remember correctly, I said to him, I was like, is everything okay, you know? And then he looked at me and he said, well, I'm still waiting for you to play the melody right. And I was like, ah. And then, you know, if you know the melody of Tune Up, it's such a simple melody, you know. And then he said, right after that, he says, you know what, put your horn away. Which, you know, was an indication that was the end of that segment of the rehearsal. You know, there would be no more playing for the day. And I remember I put my horn away, and then AT said, he says, come on into my living room, you know. And we went into his living room, and man, little did I know that was really the beginning of like 6 years of what would be, you know, just endless lessons, you know, about music and about life as well. And that, to be honest with you, still stay with me to this day. I remember him playing a lot of Sarah Vaughan, and he would just want me to listen to melodies and how melodies are played, you know. And it was really quite a lesson, because it made me realize, it was almost like AT was able to detect that, you know, my intentions, you know, although they were good intentions, you know, at this level, I needed to become a better musician and understand that music is much greater than just, you know, it's something much greater than ourselves, in our individual selves, you know, that there was a lot to learn, and I had to open up and learn about this and be a part of it, you know. So, you know, AT was, it was quite a lesson that day, and quite honestly, AT was an amazing teacher and friend, a dear friend of mine, you know, and just always so grateful for everything he passed on to me, you know. Captain's Playhouse. Over Bebop. That's all the people that have played in there, walked these streets. Kenny Clark, Sonny Greer, Cozy Cole, Max Rose. Some of AT's favorites like J.C. Irv, Papa Joe Joe. Imagine that Sunday afternoon that Philly Joe brought AT down here. Because the night before, AT's playing made Philly Joe Jones sick in his belly. He wanted to throw up. And he wasn't going to come around and listen to him anymore. He had too much talent to be rushing like that. So the next day he woke up, came down here. And Philly Joe played piano for 2 hours. And AT traded eights and fours and twos. He said after that 2 hour duets, he never rushed again. This book was called Augie's Little Hole in the Wall. I was playing there with the great John Orr on bass from Thelonious Monk fame and my great, great friend Cecil Payne. AT came down to see us play. He's going, Hey Cecil, what's up, man? Let's play one. And Cecil, don't call me Cecil. My name's Cecil. Arthur Taylor. They're both from the islands. But this is the place that AT would pick up Joe Harris from Pittsburgh and bring him, just to bring him, put a little life in him, you know, bring him back to New York. That's the kind of camaraderie they had. Eddie Locke would come by, Leroy Williams, Walter Bolden. I used to play this tune called Saucer Eyes with Cecil. For many years, I thought I was doing okay until AT sat in for the first time. And immediately, he said, Budebo! Tom, snare drum, bass drum. Budebo! Ba! Da-da-da, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da. Four-tom snare drum. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Budebo! And the crowd just went crazy from talking and being loud to totally goosebumps listening to Arthur Taylor. Once again, it keeps going back. Those guys knew how to play melodies. And that bass drum would hit you so hard, your ribs would hurt. Welcome to the Royal Roost, 1580 Broadway, between 47th and 48th. Charlie Parker, Miles Davis, Dizzy Gillespie, Bud Powell, Max Roach, Roy Haynes, all the greats were playing, including the great Arthur Taylor. The Cafe Bohemian, opening well after all these years. 15 Barrow Street, one of my favorite records, 1955. Arthur Taylor, Paul Chambers, Jackie McLean, Donald Byrd, George Wallington. A particular tune on here called J. Max Crib. Beautiful, September 9th, 1955. I think AT was the elder statesman on this record. It might have been 23. Oh, 26. Donald Byrd, 22. Jack McLean, 23. Paul Chambers, 20. Cafe Bohemia, right here. Condon's, New York City, right across from Union Square. I saw the great Arthur Taylor here many times. I also saw on Monday night's Clifford Jordan Big Band with the great John Jenkins, who I got to play with many times, unsung hero of this music. But one particular night, after Arthur finished his last set, Walter Davis was in the house and came and sat in, and they played duets for an hour, all Bud Powell tunes, and the crowd was going crazy. I remember Jimmy Heath being there. I remember Donald Byrd being there. I remember Walter Bishop being there, and I was there. And I remember them opening up with Poco Loco into John's Abbey, into Celia, also with Bud. The thing was, AT played brushes the whole time. If you want to learn how to play jazz drums, listen to Bud Powell. And I understood his teachings to me that very night, the way they phrased together. That's jazz language, Bud Powell. And those two had it that night, and I was there to see it. Condon's, Arthur Taylor.
Tyler Mitchell. I'm here to talk about Arthur Taylor, better known as A.T. I met A.T. in 1989. I met him through Mark Carey, and Mark Carey and I were very good friends. And one day he called me and said, I've been practicing with A.T. And I said, what? I said, who was playing bass? He said, it wasn't no bass. I said, man, you gotta hook it up so I can come over and play with you all. So the next day he called me and said, man, I hooked it up. We going to his house. And yeah, my first encounter playing with AT, it was wonderful. We connected right away. We started doing CTA or something like that, I believe. And then we started doing eights and fours and twos and ones. And he just stopped in the middle of it and he said, you got the gig. And I was like, the gig? I didn't even know it was a gig. But anyway, he and I got to be very close. He was the best man at my wedding when I got married. It was more than just a musical friendship. We were tight. He was like an uncle to me. You know, he was a big brother. He showed me a lot about music and about mannerism on stage, off stage, building up a show and having choreography coming on stage, coming off stage with different concepts of going in, starting out with a song with duo and. Gradually, the band builds up one by one, coming on stage. All kind of things I learned from him. I first went out on the road with him in 1989 with Steve Grossman and Trio. And that's when I really, got close to him and started playing a lot with him. After that, we started really building the Wailers band together, which was with Vincent Herring, and I think it was Willie Williams, and Larry Willis was Mark Carey, and Larry Willis at different times. And, I learned a lot from playing with him on those gigs. It's like I could go on and on talking about Arthur Taylor, but it would take all day and all night. But that's all I can say for now. Thank you.
Pete LaRocca at Yardbird Suite, West 3rd Street. They played two bass hit. He was incredible. Then I walked over here, saw the 10 o'clock show, Taylor's Wailers. Arthur Taylor and myself, we walked together over to Bradley's to see the great Billy Higgins. It doesn't even seem real to me that I was able to hang out with Arthur Taylor like that, but taking lessons with him enabled him to trust me, and he let me into his group of friends, Pete LaRocca, Art Taylor to Billy Higgins. It was like the hors d'oeuvres to the main meal to the dessert. Another time I was down there, it reminded me, it's kind of funny, I was standing next to the door with Leroy Williams, and the Taylor's Wailers wore t-shirts, and AT got done playing, it was sweaty, and he says, here you go, Farnsworth, you're an honorary member of the Wailers, and I got this sweaty shirt all over me, and it reminded me of the Mean Joe Green Coca-Cola commercial when he throws his jersey at the little kid. Two examples of Arthur Taylor's playing, one on Old Milestones and one on Gingerbread Boy. Okay, here we go. And then I'm going to show you the rudiments that Kenny Clarke showed him and Arthur Taylor showed me. And this is a 5-stroke roll and a 7-stroke roll. Those guys, everything with them was always right, left, right, left. Okay. First example is Gingerbread Boy. Now listen to how he plays the melody. It goes da 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 ba da ba da ba boom da 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 ba da ba da ba da ba da ba do ba boom. That part right there. And what he played there, pure genius. Okay. Here's the great Doug Weiss. Hey Doug.
Pulling a chime shot.
Okay, check this out. Now we're going to go on to Old Milestone and listen to once again how he plays the rhythm of the melody. Okay, so.
Okay.
the bridge. Da 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 da. Ba do ba do boo ba do ba ba da ba da 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 da. Kenny Clark 5-stroke, 7-stroke roll. So it's going to start with the right hand. 7. Trading fours, and they're gonna say, "Man, that guy's got some Kenny Clark." Here's something else the great Arthur Taylor used to do all the time. And just because I'm feeling so charitable, there's another thing I used to do all the time. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the second installment on the great Arthur Taylor. And for your listening enjoyment for these next couple of weeks, I would put on It's a Blue World, Red Garland. I would put on Chase Giant Steps. I would put on my favorite record of all time, AT's Delights. And I would put on a great record that was made in the late 80s, 90s called Mad for Tad, Continuum. Kenny Barron, Ron Carter, Arthur Taylor, Jimmy Heath, and Slide Hampton playing the music of Tad Dameron. Ladies and gentlemen, you can't go wrong. Put on anything by the great Arthur Taylor. And of course, go back and study Bud Powell. That was advice from Kenny Clark to him. And it's my advice to you, jazz lovers.